So what I'm going to present today, I've been working on in the area of probabilistic thinking for now, you know, around 10-12 years, and I found it very interesting how poorly we understand the idea of probability and how poorly it is represented in the textbooks. And somehow it seems that we have a very limited understanding of this particular area of mathematics, although we need to do in many areas of mathematics. And I'm aware that recently Raki took a workshop on algebraic thinking. So I could not prepare much on probabilistic thinking, but I picked up a very crucial aspect of probability, which is the idea of random. And the title that you can see, it's very, very random, is primarily because, you know, this idea of what we mean by random and how we look at it. This is a quote actually given with one of my students when I'm doing an exercise, and I gave him a task to do, which I'll soon share. When I shared the task with her, this was the first thing that she said: it's very, very random. And I found it pretty catching that, you know, it has to be random. And then why was she calling it very, very random? So I picked this line from this child, and I made this as my title of my today's workshop. What I'm going to primarily talk about, I'm not going to do too much details also in this concept of randomness. I will just be introducing the idea of randomness and how they are manifested in certain physical objects, how we concretize randomness, what was the historical genesis. I'll just hit on that a bit, that the historical genesis of the idea of chance and how randomizers or random generators were used in the earlier civilizations. Then I'm going to share in the second part, I'm going to share one of my studies in which, you know, I had seen children's ideas about their understanding or misconceptions or how they conceive or, you know, how they intuitively look into the idea of randomness. And then I'm going to conclude by the things I could not touch in this workshop. So let me begin by first, as I said, the first phase would be just giving a glimpse of the historical basis. And perhaps I'll try to finish this by 3:50, because I want to keep 10 minutes for talking and discussing the idea of randomness, since it is in any case less explored and very little do we know about it, especially at the school level. At the higher secondary or the secondary level, maybe we deal with the idea of randomness, but when it comes to understanding children or children's understanding of randomness, we have very little understanding in this area. So if you look at this term random, and if you just do a Google search, you know, the first thing, I mean, I picked these three text, three boxes that you can see, one on the left hand side, the right, middle, and the left side corner. These are primarily the words that you see when you talk about the phase random or randomness. So in the morning, when I did a quick search on the internet, you know, when it says the definition, this is what you see on the internet. It says that random is the quantity or state of lacking a pattern or principle of organization or unpredictability. So in other words, there are another sub-construct attached with randomness, as if I have to just decode, or, you know, if I have to just kind of break this whole sentence into parts, there are three starking phrases that it's talking about. There should not be any pattern and or a principle of organization. Sorry, first it has to be a quality or a state. That means quality or a state or which is present in something. It has to be concretized. It has to be looked through some phase. It has to be a state or a quality of something. I mean, that is not defined here of what. And there should not be any pattern or organization in it, which means that you cannot see something which you can repeat, or you see that it is done in an organized manner or even a periodic manner. If I may use the term, it is arbitrary. However, arbitrariness is not same as randomness. Now, there's a difference between arbitrariness and randomness, but to a very lay person, as the internet says, it could be associated to that. And finally, is using the word unpredictability, which is also related to the idea of chance or futureness or guessing what is going to come in the future. So it has to have an idea of unpredictability, which means you do not know what it is going to be. If that is the state that we're talking, then perhaps you are defining randomness according to the internet. The second definition that it gives is oddness or eccentricity. You know, when we say that there are very few odds of something happen, you know, the odds of happening this, you know, when we use this in a layman language, we say the situation is very odd. Something like that, they probably want to say that, you know, since the event has very chances of being very odd, it is perhaps random. However, if you look at the textbooks, they call it, or if you ask someone who's done a little bit of probability, when we asked, you know, class 11, 12 students, or to some people who have already done some state of probability, if you ask them what is randomness, especially when I do this with my quantitative classes, when I take my first few quantitative classes and I ask them what do they mean by randomness, most often I get this kind of a statement, similar to the statement which is marked in green, that it is about happening or not happening of one event, which should not affect the happening or not happening of another event. So compare these two statements now. This is that, you know, something random means that something has happened in the past and that happening will not affect the happening of another event in the future. And if you just happen to talk to any person offhand, the last three phases are most likely, you will get most likely the last three phases, which is, they'll say it's something that just happens. Randomness is something that just happens, you know, it doesn't have a past. And it doesn't show any pattern. So, which means, you know, again, coming on to non-predictability or something which just happens in a very layman language, this is what you're going to get. So if you compare these three, you know, there are some hits and some misses, which I'm going to discuss by the end of my presentation. But please make a note of it. I don't want to, you know, come out, I don't want to break the suspense right now. But I'm going to come back to this slide while I'm going to talk back that where are we hitting and what are the misses in these two, three lines that I've displayed here. None of them is complete. It's, you know, it's something like when we say there is an elephant in the room and some person touches some part of it. The famous story of blindfolded people touching an elephant. Somebody touches the body of the elephant and think it's a wall, and somebody touches the legs of the elephant and think it's a pillar, or somebody touches the tail of the elephant and thinks it's like a snake or a rope. So I would take that analogy to these three, four phases that I have picked up. Again, I would say I have randomly picked up and flashed it onto this slide. They do not tell you the complete story. They hit on some part of randomness, and which I'm going to conclude. In my concluding slide, I'm going to come back to this. So, but to begin with, the idea of randomness, let's peep into the history. So you see, historically, if we try to look at what was the idea of having something random, or how did this idea got its genesis, is because we would, you know, there were many anecdotes where you had to talk about chance, the chance of happening or not happening something, an event or a sequence or just, you know, something which has to be happen, an outcome which you're not too sure which will happen or not. So and why was this idea of chance being done is because, you know, they had to solicit some divine direction, which means if you have to make a decision in a situation where there are chances of happening or not happening, then obviously you solicit it to the divine direction. You solicit divine direction in it. So let me give you an example here. So for example, you know, there are two people who've been caught stealing, and both of them are obviously denying the fact, and you have to make a decision. How do you do it? One of the ways is you connect many evidences against it, but suppose you fail to do that, and what do you do? Or certain properties have to be allotted, and both the parties are equally powerful. Whom should you allot the what decision should you do? Or you're looking at certain events that have been happening into the past and you want to make a prediction for the future, like weather prediction, or, you know, an event which is going to reoccur in the future. So how do you talk about that, whether it will happen in the future or not? So to capture all these aspects which were happening, which the human beings were very integrated to decode or to understand, they had to depend on some kind of generators for chance. I mean, it couldn't be as abstract or arbitrary. They had to find some manifestations on which chance could be seen. And thus we started resorting to the idea of generating randomness. And so as I've written, that chance mechanism were used to divide properties, delegate civil responsibilities or privileges, settle disputes among the neighbors, or choose a strategy to follow the course of a battle. You know, when the battle is in between and you want to finish it in between, how do you take a decision on that? So we started depending upon many objects. Some of them were shells, pebbles, or fingers. And these are, you know, personal devices as fingers, which were present in our body to manifest randomness. So if you look at the history, there were several things or several generators which were being used to generate randomness, so-called. If I use the term dices to this to begin with, we find that there were many objects that were being used in the past. For example, the heels of hoofed animals such as deer. The picture on the right shows you the heels of certain animals. If you look at these pictures very carefully, the black and white ones, you would see they look like some bit of cuboidal. They have a little cavity in them, but when you throw them, you do not know where it would fall. So there is a sense of unpredictability, and depending upon where it would fall, you take a decision on that. So they were called, these astragalies were being used to take decisions. Then there were also specially carved stones, which came much, much later when we had these skills of carving stones and rocks, something like this is like an icosahedron that you can see, and the carvings have been made. Later, we also found some baked six-sided dices, which I've again represented on the right. But before the dices were being used, there were many other things which were being done to make decisions. For example, we were using reeds, which had one part, this is like goatees. You know, so this is like, what do I call? Not exactly goatees, these are something like shells. Shells of pistachios, so they were concaved and convex, and you throw them, and wherever they fall, then you take an idea, because you know it's believed that it may fall in any direction. There were also ivory staves, one side colored and another side blank, something which is very similar to tossing a coin. It could fall on anything. They were throwing sticks. They were also throwing sticks, as you can see on the in the picture, that there were sticks which were very thin and they had some markings. Now, I'm not too sure how these throwing sticks were used, because there are two different stories related to these sticks. One say that, you know, the number of sticks that you could capture, this was in China, the bunch of sticks that you could capture, odd or even how they were, that was one way of deciding, taking certain decision. The other process of taking decision was you throw these sticks into the air and let them fall freely, and the manner in which they fall, upside down or, you know, the whichever manner they fall, then you try to use them as randomizers or random generators. Also, yet there is another story on the marking of these sticks. So the different sticks were marked differently, like we have faces in the cube or in our dice, in the cube dice that we use very commonly in our board games. So the manner in which they fall and the number which comes at the top is used to give you the outcome of those. Odd even games were being played, and a very famous game which is being played with respect to odd events was at the time of Emperor Augustus of Greece. Now, as you could see in the picture, in this case, you know, the people had to they used to take a bunch of objects into their hand, probably pebbles or shells, and one had to make a quick decision whether it is odd or even. So one can make out that when these games were taking place, people did have a sense of numbers, whereas in the earlier stages, even without the sense of numbers, you could play the game of chance. However, when you look at this particular example of odd and evens, people would have started making some number sense so that they could discriminate between what is odd or even, and the other person had to, you know, make a guess. So if the guess is right, then he wins the stake, and if the guess is wrong between odd and even, he misses it. Very famously, I take back my words on saying very famously, or actually it's quite infamous. We, even in our Rig Vedas, there are many games which have been listed even in our Rig Vedas, which talk about how we, as in the Indus Valley civilization, were playing games with many generators of randomness. There is also a Lament of a Gambler. There is a poem which is done. I've never seen this. I've only read this from a book, that there is a poem or a song related to chance, which is called Lament of a Gambler. But definitely we do know about a famous epic which was based on the story of gambling, the Mahabharat. And then if you look at Mahabharat, obviously, you know, I think people who have joined are almost of my age or maybe nearer to my age. Everybody would have seen the famous epic that came, B.R. Chopra's Mahabharat, where, you know, there was a chokar which was being played and a dice had to be thrown. Well, that actually is not a correct story. If you go and read the books properly and historical anecdotes of what happened during the time, perhaps you will come to know that idea, during Mahabharat, in that game of chance, or in the game where their famous the whole story of Mahabharat was made, they did not have any cubical dice or any cuboidal dice that was being shown in that in the TV serial. In fact, they had kauris in their hands, and the skill was to estimate the number of kauris. So they had to devise stakes. So both the parties had to think of some stakes, and they had to first devise a mechanism of the number of times they would play this game. And then they had to make a quick estimation of the kauris that one catches up into their hand. Something like that. It was something related to that. There's no point going into the details of this, because the idea here is that I just wanted to point out that the kind of image that we have, which, you know, which has been idolized through our TV serials, was actually wrong. But besides that, there are evidences of two-sided dices, three-sided dices, tetrahedrons being used as dices, octahedrons being used as dices, six-sided platonic solids, so-called. All these platonic solids, there are enough evidences in various civilization, including the Indus Valley civilization, which tell us how we were, how humans were dependent upon these objects as random generators to give you outputs. Now, till now, by the way, I want to put a caveat here. Till now, I have not discussed what is randomness, although I've been using this phrase again and again. And I told you I'm keeping the suspense till the end. But so far, what I've tried to give you is a glimpse that, you know, since randomness is not an idea, which is a very abstract idea, and to understand that we have to resort to some kind of objects, whether it could be using fingers or throwing sticks or playing odd even games or making or using devices like kauris or head and tail, or dices, maybe kind of platonic or non-platonic solids, whichever. One aspect that I wanted to bring through all these examples is that the idea of randomness, if you look at the historical dates, the idea of randomness was being seen through these objects, was being built through these objects. Now, all these objects, sorry, I've missed lottery in this. Lottery was another aspect which was being used as for you know, to seek decisions in, for making decisions in chance. So, you know, lottings of plotting, allotting a plot to a person or making a decision when somebody has to, be given a land or something like that. Property decisions were messy. Or even, you know, there are even stories when the decision of, let's say, a murderer was made, was to be made on the basis of lottery. So you have chits and, you know, randomly. Again, I'm using the phrase random in the sense that I had shown in my first few slides, which common people understand, is you pick anything, unpredictability, and you see this idea. So what we've gathered till now is that to teach children randomness, we can clearly say that it doesn't come, the idea of chance or randomness doesn't come so easily to them. That is why we resort to certain kind of objects. Now, in all these objects that I've talked about, every object has a unique property of its own. So a head and a tail, or the reeds or the ivory staves that I'm talking about, are different from using dices, and the throwing sticks, the way they were being used, is different from, again, how fingers being used. And the idea of odd or even games, which you can still see it on your screen, was very different from, again, any of the ideas that I've discussed. So with each manifestation that you choose, you also make games, or you also attach the idea of unpredictability on the basis of the object that you are choosing. So one key point, one takeaway that we take from whatever examples I've said till now, is that to understand randomness, one, you need an appropriate object. How do we define an appropriate object? We may make out pointers to how do we select these objects, and on the basis of the objects that we select, then we try to play games or predict their outcomes. So both, all these aspects are quite intermingled. So something that we could draw, as I said, from these objects is that if you see all the objects that I have showcased till now, there is physical symmetry in the objects. You could not think of thinking any randomness without talking about fairness. If the object itself is biased, now I'm introducing this term bias because you see this in the textbooks, but hardly do we talk about the idea of biasness with our children. First of all, we need to understand that biasness has to be eliminated. So the objects are physically symmetric in such a way that they bring out fair outcomes. Whether you pick a symmetrical dais, or you talk about throwing the sticks, or you talk about kodis, or falling off a coin, there have to be fair outcomes. And this comes through the physical symmetry of the object that you're talking about. Now we've looked at randomness in an event which is yet to occur. As I told you, it is manifested in the shape of the object. And since it is manifested in the shape of the object, now here comes a caveat to it, that can it be maneuvered? Can it be skilled through skilled hands? So children often have this kind of an assumption that if I know, you know, they say that, you know, some people have a skill of using those objects in a particular way. So if you know how to throw an object, or, you know, with the speed of the object, how you throw it, you can predict the outcome that is going to come. So that has to be eliminated. The human interference has to be eliminated. So the object which is being chosen to create randomness should be fair, should be physically symmetric, and the human factors or even environmental factors should not be able to maneuver them. So on these little assumptions that we had, I'm going to now come to part B of my presentation, which is I'm going to share a study that I had done with class 8 and 7 students around 3 to 4 years back. And this has got published in one of the ICMI, a very famous mathematical conferences that we go to. And again, it's very famous in the mathematical education world. It's called ICMME. So in the last, the one that I presented was this I'm taking it from that, where I share the understanding or how children make conceptions of randomness through dice. So what I did was, it was an exploratory approach with class 17 students, where I gave them certain random generators and they had to choose an appropriate random generator, and they had to give us their, they had to substantiate it with their arguments why they had to pick this as a choice. So what we picked up, I took this idea from whatever history that I've shared with. I gave them 8 polyhedrons. 4 were platonic solids that exhibit perfect symmetry. Now remember, I spoke about symmetry being manifested, could be in the physical object that we choose. So we gave them a regular tetrahedron. Is there a problem in my audio? Am I audible?
There is a bit of a disturbance there, honey.
I don't know if this is true at my end, because I can also hear the disturbance.
Okay, I then somebody must have...
Somebody unmuted. Must have unmuted.
Yeah. I will just check. Jeenat, if you can mute the person, whoever has unmuted.
Yes.
So we gave them 8, 4 were platonic solids, a regular tetrahedron, a regular cube, a regular octahedron, and a regular icosahedron. We could not make the 5th platonic solids because it was very different. We could not produce it by our hands, and we thought that we may not even use it. So we gave them 8, 4 platonic solids, perfect platonic symmetrical objects. A regular I'm not too sure, but people who are not from the mathematical background can see that hand where 5 of them are given. Discard the one with the pentagons. So the 4 on the left, you can choose. These are the 4 platonic solids that we gave them. We also gave them 4 partially symmetric polyhedrons consisting of 2 pyramids and 2 prisms. The pyramids were, one was with the square base and the other was with the hexagon base. So again, people, non-mathematical people, pyramid, you would have heard this term in terms of Egyptian pyramids. Egyptian pyramid is a pyramid which has square base and the sides are triangle. We gave them that. And the other pyramid that we gave them, it had a base of a regular hexagon and there were then 6 triangles joining at a point. And so these were 2 partially symmetric polyhedrons and there were 2 prisms. One of the common prism that you hear is the rectangular prism, which is also called the cuboid. And the other one was a hexagonal prism, which means there were 6, there were 2 hexagons and there were 6 rectangles adjoining these hexagons. So we gave them these 8 polyhedrons and we asked them to choose whichever object that they would like to choose from it. I'm going to present you the study of 2 groups, which and how they looked at it and how their ideas were quite similar despite choosing 2 different objects. So what happened is when we gave them these 8 objects, there were around 4 to 5 people in each group. One of the groups, I forgot to say this, that the edge length of all the solids were kept same. So all the solids, their edges, their lengths were same and there were no markings being done on the polyhedrons. And most of these solids, as I told you, we picked them because we had found enough evidence of these being used at some point in the history. So we know that at some point in the history, one of them, have been used. So we were confident in giving them to the student. So the students spent enough time in their exploration. In fact, 40% of the time, they were only playing with these objects. They threw them, unko roll kiya, unko pheka, unko rotate kiya. The pyramids were being rotated. Some were thrown on the ground. Then, they tossed it up and they let it fall. Then they put it on the chair. Then they put it on the table. Then they let it do it on the floor. So a lot of time was spent only on judging the orientation and free motion of the shapes. And this was done in such a rigorous manner that this led to the first round of elimination. So I can say that the first round of elimination was done on the basis of the mechanisms that obstruct free fall.
So the first criteria that they looked at in selecting or rejecting the object was whether the objects could freely fall. So I could now deduce that the first thing, the only thing that they were looking at here was if it cannot be maneuvered through human beings. So they were trying to minimize the effect of friction, which means the environmental factors. They were trying to minimize human factors or any intervention that could interfere between the fall of the object or rotation of the object. So the two groups which choose, one group choose an icosahedron. Now, icosahedron is a shape which has eight triangular faces. So it looks like, you know, four triangular faces on the top and four triangular faces at the bottom. Why they choose this icosahedron? Because, you know, it could be rolled out easily. So if you throw an octahedron. Icosahedron has 20 faces, 20 triangles, and it resembles like a ball. So they found this shape. One of the groups found this shape most appealing because they could see that it could roll multiple times like a ball. So there was an ease of rolling, and hence they deduced that it cannot be maneuvered. The other group chose an octahedron, which had eight faces, four on the top and four at the bottom. And this they associated by throwing. And what they did was they initially, in fact, they worked on the aspect of elimination. Unhone pehle tetrahedron aur icosahedron pehle hata diya, taking it like extreme cases. Tetrahedron, they said, has only four faces, so they excluded it. He said there are very less faces in tetrahedron. And icosahedron has 20 faces. So he said, you know, it's going to be a lot of frustration if you play with icosahedron. Ab jab do hata diye, to baki 6 mein se beech wala jo tha, jisme 8 faces the, unhone wo select kar liya. And I would call it a median piece, you know, because it has 8. So these are the arguments that they gave on selecting these pieces. And after we saw them and talking to them, what we could form, yeah, 340, okay. So what we could understand from the games that they were playing, or when they finalized their piece, we could put it up into these five aspects. One is the idea of sample space. If you could remember, we had given them 8 polyhedrons, and the cube was also a part of the group. However, they did not pick it. They picked the shape which has more than 6 faces. One had 20 faces and the other had 6 faces. So the kind of argument that they made was that they wanted to have a large sample space. Aur large sample space se kya hoga? Ki kisi ek face ke aane ke chances utne hi kam ho jayenge proportionally. So if you have 8 faces, the proportion of getting one face would be 1/8, and the proportion of getting, and if you choose icosahedron, you will have the 1/20 chances of getting one face. So for them, this idea of sample space was the first preliminary expectation to choose an object for randomness, that the sample space should be large as compared to what they were already playing with. Then the idea of unpredictability. Both the groups, even though they had picked up different objects, both the groups were keenly observed the way the objects were behaving. How freely could they fall? How freely could be these external forces could be eliminated or minimized? So the unpredictability was attached to the symmetrical fall or fairness, if I can come to the object. And that goes on to the next aspect of fairness. Since the objects were perfectly symmetrical, they could understand that these are fair also. The fourth point was extremely important, because this helped us to see how they make mistakes or the misconceptions that they attach to cubes as well. Exhaustiveness of the sample space.
Now, you know, when we drilled and we asked them why they have picked up these two objects, they said that, you know, for them, an outcome which comes out or any outcomes, the series of outcomes behave in a cyclic manner,
which means agar 9 ab aaya hai, to 9 ke aane ke dobara 9 ke aane ke chances jab pure 8 khatam ho jayenge, 8 साइड्स एक बार आ जाएंगे उसके बाद आएगा. सो फॉर देम सो लेट मी पुट इट अप आई डोंट नो इफ आई एम पुटिंग इट करेक्टली लेट मी रीस्टेट इट व्हिच मीन दैट सपोज इन दिस थ्रो आई हैव गॉट 5 एट द टॉप एंड आई हैव टेकन एन ऑक्टाहेड्रन. So my chances of getting 5 will come after I've exhausted the other 7 outcomes. So after I've exhausted the other 7 outcomes, only then 5 would reoccur. Similarly, if you have an icosahedron, you would have 20 occurrences before a next reoccurrence. Very strange concept that they came up, and we could connect this to their idea of prior conditioning, which is the final point that I've put in here. Because the students were, they had lot of conditioning related to playing cube as a dice, and there they see that, you know, if 6 has come out, the chances of getting 6 the next time are very less. It comes, you know, rather 1/6 time you get a 6. So once you've exhausted all the 5 chances, you get 6. So their conditioning to cube was playing a very pivotal role in their conditioning and the exhaustiveness of the sample space. Sorry, I'm going a bit quick here, because I have to finish this in next 5 minutes. And so what we could conclude from this study is that the students were relying on the physical configuration of the objects while perceiving randomness. Their logic was largely based on the physical judgment of the objects that governed their understanding of randomness. And they related randomness to the size of the sample space, to unpredictability, fairness and possibilities of non-maneuverability by hands or by human beings or by environmental factors. There, for them, the shape of the object or the physical symmetry and the orientation, the number of faces and the mechanism in which the dice could be thrown, spin or rolled were the key components in selecting a dice, because they spent a lot of time in only looking at the mechanism in which the dice can be thrown, whether it can be spin or it has to be rolled. You know, what is the good way of playing with the dice? Homogeneity in the shape was deemed to ensure equal chances of all faces showing up, which means the idea of fairness. And unpredictability was easiest to claim, as it was only associated with non-maneuverability. And now I'm going to conclude this study by making its connection with Karl Popper's interpretation of probability. Perhaps why I'm making this interpretation, why I'm highlighting this interpretation, because we do not talk about Karl Popper's interpretation of probability anywhere near to our textbooks. Our textbooks are loaded with only classical interpretation of probability, and very little on the frequentist approach of probability. But since we're dealing with objects, this is not even there in any bit of, not even textbooks or even with games of chances where we could talk about Karl Popper's interpretation of probability. Karl Popper's interpretation of probability, which is also known as the propensity theory or the dispositional theory of probability, it questions the statistical approach of measuring probability and interpreting probability as a property entrenched in the experimental conditions. I'll tell you what it means first. Let me read it and then I'll explain it in very simple words. It says that physically existing dispositional properties of an experimental setting interact and combine to form generating conditions, and it is these conditions which, when taken holistically, define the probability of a situation. Let me explain you what it means. If you do not understand the heavy loaded words, please do not get baffled. I'm going to explain it. What it primarily means is, agar aapko probability batani hai, next, matlab fortuitous batani hai ek event ki, to aap uski conditions पढ़िए या कंडीशंस का जायजा लीजिए जिन कंडीशंस की वजह से पुरानी सिचुएशन हुई थी. विच मीन्स दैट यू स्टडी द सिचुएशन. सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल, इफ यू टॉकिंग अबाउट प्रिडिक्टिंग अ वेदर और प्रिडिक्टिंग रेन, यू अंडरस्टैंड ऑल द कंडीशंस इन विच रेन हैपेंड लास्ट टाइम. And you, when you associate all these conditions, then you can perhaps talk about the chances of raining the next time. So it's not, it doesn't, so if you can understand, if you have any understanding of probability or the theories of probability, this is not related to classical probability. This is not even related to the frequentist approach. Frequentist approach kehti hai kitni frequency thi hone ki. Wo frequency ki baat nahi kar rahe hain. Wo keh rahe hain aap conditions dekhiye. अगर आपके पास एक डाइस को, अब हमारे स्टूडेंट्स के लिए मैं इसको कैसे इंटरप्रेट कर रही हूँ, कि अगर एक डाइस को फेंकने का तरीका, उसका मेक जो था, उसका किस तरह से वो फेंका गया, किस तरह से उसकी शेप थी, अगर वो एक आउटकम आपका आया है बिकॉज ऑफ सम कंडीशंस, तो उन कंडीशंस को अगर हम दोबारा रिपीट कर लें तो बहुत चांसेस है कि वही आउटपुट आपका नेक्स्ट टाइम भी आएगा.
सो इफ यू रिपीट द कंडीशंस ऑफ एन इवेंट दैट हैज हैपेंड, देयर आर क्वाइट राइट चांसेस दैट द इवेंट विल अगेन हैपन,
प्रोवाइडेड द कंडीशंस मैच कंप्लीटली.
सो दिस इज व्हाट आवर स्टूडेंट्स आल्सो केम अप, दैट दे लुक्ड एट द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द डाइस and the dispositional factors which is making the structural characteristics of the object, which means the homogeneity, the symmetry, the number of faces, and the external forces, gravity, friction, landing on the stabilized position. So if I connect, agar ye sari conditions, agar homogeneity waisi ki waisi rahe, symmetry waisi ki waisi rahe, number of faces utni rahenge, gravitational force waisi hi rahe, landing waisi stabilization rahe, friction waisi rahe, wind waisi hi rahegi, तो और तो मेरे चांसेस हैं कि जो नंबर या जो आउटपुट मेरा अभी आया है, प्रोवाइडेड ऑल दीज कंडीशंस आर एग्जैक्टली द सेम, देन देयर इज अ ब्राइट चांस दैट आई एम गोइंग टू गेट द सेम इवेंट द नेक्स्ट टाइम, एंड दिस डजंट हैपन, दैट इज व्हाई वी डू नॉट गेट द आउटपुट सेम टाइम. ओके, सो आई थिंक आई फिनिश्ड वेल ऑन टाइम. जस्ट नाउ ऑन रैपिंग इट अप, एज आई टोल्ड यू इन द बिगिनिंग दैट let me go to the first slide. I told you that this slide, I told you that each one of them is like talking about the elephant in the room, and none of them gives them the complete picture. The first one, now whatever presentation that I've given today is just off coming of an event. The propensity theory talks about chances of or the probability of an event to be occur. Nowhere I have talked about many other things that can be associated, which means sequences, random mixtures, or outputs. When I'm going to talk about, since I'm not talking about that, so jab hum yahan par keh rahe hain ki lack of pattern, pattern ek event mein to ho hi nahi sakta. Pattern to tab hoga jab aapke paas continuity of events hoga. All this hogi jab aapke paas bahut sare events honge. टेक्स्टबुक में भी हम जब बात करेंगे कि हैपनिंग ऑफ वन इवेंट डज नॉट, व्हिच मींस वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट मल्टीपल इवेंट्स. सो ऑल दीस एस्पेक्ट्स आर नॉट क्वाइट रिलेटेड टू द वे आई हैव रिट और द वे वी हैव बीन लुकिंग इनटू रैंडमनेस. फॉर ऑल द एग्जांपल्स दैट आई हैव टॉक्ड अबाउट, वी ओनली लुक एट द इवेंट, द रैंडम इवेंट व्हिच इज गोइंग टू कम अप, व्हिच मींस देयर आर मेनी अदर एस्पेक्ट्स रिलेटेड टू रैंडमनेस, नॉट जस्ट एन इवेंट, एंड दोज आर रैंडम सीक्वेंसेस. रैंडम सीक्वेंसेस की मैंने बिल्कुल बात नहीं की है, और रैंडम सीक्वेंसेस जैसे कि मैं आपको एक छोटा सा एग्जांपल देती हूँ. सपोज कर लिए ये जो चार मैंने एग्जांपल्स दिए हुए हैं, इन चारों सीक्वेंसेस में आपको कौन सा बहुत रैंडम सीक्वेंस लग रहा है? आई कैन आस्क क्वेश्चंस लाइक दिस आल्सो विद चिल्ड्रन, एंड वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग आंसर्स दैट यू गेट. यू नो द फर्स्ट वन, वुड यू कॉल दैट एज रैंडम? व्हाई और व्हाई नॉट द सेकंड वन, थर्ड और द फोर्थ वन? If you see the series of events, now these are series of events, but here when I'm talking about, I'm not talking about randomness of an event, I'm talking about the sequence being random. So this will have a different way of understanding. Then certain aspects that we have not talked about, which are there in the textbooks, are random mixtures. You know those urns where you have green, red, blue and white balls, and you pick a ball from an urn and then you either replace or you do not replace. They are based on the idea of random mixtures. We yet to understand how children understand random mixtures. Then random motion, which is very much, or random paths. Both these aspects are related to the idea of physics or chemistry. You know, when we know that when we say the electrons behave, the path of an electron, the motion of electron is very random. What do we exactly mean by this? Or in fact, when we say that, you know, when the rain falls, the raindrops fall in a very random way. So they are like falling, or the path with the raindrops or the motion of those are falling at the surface in a very random way. Where would they fall? And in a grid or whatever. So we have not talked about that. So in the end, what I'm trying to, let me summarize what I did, is randomness is an extremely complex construct
but it is a foundational one when studying probability. Children need to be given avenues to play with concrete generators of randomness, and the more objects that you can bring it into their classroom, the more versatile they would be. And I could only talk about random events or random outcomes today, but we need to explore more on random mixtures, random sequences, and random motion and random paths. So I end my presentation well on time to open for discussion. I'm sorry if I've went very fast, but if you want to have more understand more on probability, I really welcome people who can join hands with me in understanding and doing probability with children. Please write to me at my email, which is flashing on the PowerPoint.
Yes, if you have any questions or comments, please feel free to share by unmuting or typing on chat. It was really interesting, Hani, to see all these ideas that you had shared with us about probability and how students understand probability. I think it is a very nice idea. However, when we teach probability in the classroom at secondary level, so I think what happens is that students get mired only in the formula itself. So perhaps doing these kind of activities in the beginning with them, do you think that would help? And what is the way forward? If you can share some ideas with us.
Surely, so that of course is as you said, that when we look at children, or even I've interviewed many people who are in class 11 and 12 and they study probability. For them, initial stages when they start looking at probability, they say ki to bahut hi simple hai, numerator sample size likho, numerator mein, if they see it and not even an extension, they see even easier than fractions. They the fraction hai upar kuch numerator likh diya, next year denominator likh diya. So as I said, that we need to listen. Probability for somehow is quite underrepresented in our textbooks, and the frequentist approach is not dealt fairly enough in our textbook. If we have to deal with all these, and if we have to listen how children understand the ideas of making chance, yes, we need to give them lot of experiments and activities to do with these kind of things. And from here, once you start looking into, how they make sense of it, then you can either take the classical approach of enumerating the sample space and then talking about probability, or you can then take the frequentist approach of understanding probability. But I believe that first, since all these objects are there in the textbooks, hum on mixtures, dice, coins, sabki baat karte hain, but I don't think so. I've ever seen a class which has done any experiment with dices, or at the most they do it with just with coin, because that is the one that is given in class 8 textbook. There is a table which some schools do, sometimes teachers are enthusiastic to do it, sometimes they take even that exercise in a very theoretical way to just capture the essence that the more number of throws you have, you will definitely come to a 50-50 chance of getting head and tail. But real experimentation doesn't give you that answer. When you actually throw a dice, as many as times you may do it, you will never reach 50-50, exact 50-50. So there's a very strong belief that gets attached to probability, which is the idea of undeterminism. You see, most of the maths is quite deterministic in nature. We know the answer. लेकिन जब हम प्रोबेबिलिटी पे आते हैं तो वो फियर इसलिए बिकॉज वो बहुत ही अनडिटर्मिनिस्टिक नेचर है प्रोबेबिलिटी का, तो शायद टीचर्स भी डरती हैं कराने में और शायद हम भी डरते हैं उसको आगे ले जाने में.
थैंक यू हनीत. या प्लीज आस्क
मैम, मैं ये थोड़ा पूछना चाहता हूँ कि हाउ कैन वी कम टू द डिसीजन फॉर डिसाइडिंग द रैंडमनेस in the behavior of a student. Can we relate it to the chapters of probability?
Sir, I didn't understand. What do you mean, behavior of the students?
Students, sometimes in the class, the students behave in some other way, sometimes in other way. So can it be concluded on the basis of this chapter?
I think perhaps what you are trying to say is whether the behavior, randomness in behavior can be taken as an example of randomness and to use to teach probability. Is that what you are trying to ask?
Sure, ma'am. Sure. This is the same thing.
Here, sir, could you pick up this you're trying to make an analogy. Could you brought me here? You know, often if you have to ask students, especially when I take my quantitative classes and I ask them, what do you mean by random? Or I ask them, when we talk about sample spaces, sample kaise logi? So, agar aapne kisi ne bhi research padha hoga, to usme aata hai random sampling. Ye shabd jo hai bahut zyada common hai usme. और जब आप पूछेंगे कि रैंडम सैंपलिंग कैसे होगा तो वो यही आंसर दिया जाता है कि एक को लेने का मतलब है दूसरा आएगा कि नहीं आएगा या दूसरे के आंसर्स चांसेस उसके पहले की चॉइस पे नहीं है. मैं यहाँ पर जो मैंने बहुत स्टार्टिंग में बात की थी वो एक टर्म है आर्बिटरीनेस. आप जिस चीज को कह रहे हैं वो शायद आर्बिटरीनेस ऑफ बिहेवियर है जिसको हम रैंडम मान लेते हैं, एक वर्ड ले लेते हैं बिकॉज द वर्ड्स आर वेरी सिनोनिमस टू ईच अदर. But arbitrariness is something which is very different. Randomness is a mathematical construct where it has to have principles. Like random numbers, when we talk about, they follow a principle of generation. Okay, it comes from chaos. So there is a procedure, there is a scientific process of talking about randomness. But when we talk about random behavior, I think we are more or less talking in terms of erraticness or arbitrariness in their behavior, which means that we are talking about there is constant behavior. It's not uniform, but so we use this term, but it doesn't make any sense to connect it in terms of mathematics.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir, for asking these questions. Any other questions?
Excuse me, ma'am. Can we talk about randomness? Like we see sometimes we fill official forms and there is CAPTCHA that we have to type. Is that an example of randomness? Or
yes,
I not Q, X, 6, 8, 9, like we have to retype that when we are filling some of the forms. So is that based on randomness or related?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, more so because the algorithm which is written behind them is on the basis of generating random sequences. That is an example. That is a brilliant example of you can use it. But this is only an example. But children will not understand the underlying principles of how they are generating. And so concrete objects, the more that you can use and experiment with these objects, that I think would be crucial. But that is a good example. I take that.
Okay, that is randomness of random sequences. Okay.
Yeah, the algorithm through which it is created follows the sequence. That is a random sequence.
Okay, okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. I have also shared Zeenat has also shared the Google Form link that is for the feedback for the session. Please fill it up. It is very important for us to know whether the timing is convenient and if you want any other ideas to be discussed in these synergy seminars, please definitely let us know. Any other questions?
Yeah, I have a question. Is there time for a short question?
Yes, sure, Janaki. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. Yeah, so I just wanted to ask that, the propensity theory that Hanit, you talked about, does it have anything to say about the law of large numbers also? Like when we are saying that, when we do a coin experiment, when you throw a coin a sufficiently large number of times, then the empirical probability will approach the theoretical probability. So does the propensity theory have anything to indicate in that regard also?
Hi, Janaki, first of all. Well, thanks for asking this question. These are three different schools of thought, if I may say so. The classical one only enumerates the sample space. The empirical or the frequentist one talks about the frequency in generating the data. So you will have to do an experiment multiple times in terms of frequentist approach. Mm-hmm. However, the propensity theory is, if I may so call it, it is more, you would relate it well to it. It's more akin to the Bayesian theory, where the conditional probability. So if the conditions underlying or the underlying principles or the dispositions are the same, then so you can predict the happening or not happening of an event in the future. So this propensity theory fails. In fact, this is the what may I say? This is the strength of the theory, that you can even talk about probability of a single event, which you cannot in terms of frequentist or experimental probability. In experimental probability, you can never talk about probability of one event. You'll have to do a series of events to come to that one event. However, the propensity theory, that's the strength of propensity theory. You can even talk about just one probability of happening or not having of a single event. So they're you know, completely different in those terms.
Okay, thanks. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, any other questions?
There is
one. Can we generate randomness? This is the question.
Can we generate true randomness? There's nothing as false or untrue randomness. Randomness has to be randomness. And there are algorithms to generate random numbers. We know that. But by the way, I think what you're saying about randomness are random sequences. So you can create random sequences. I'm assuming you're talking about random sequences. That's the most common thing that we talk about. You know, randomness, we only attach to random sequences, a sequence being generated. But so random sequences, yes, there are ways of generating random sequences. But when you're talking about random events, they get manifested through these or to other aspects. But I don't know what I hope I've answered. I don't truly get it. But definitely there is no false randomness. That's what I can say. I don't know. If you could open your mic and ask, it will be clear. I don't know if I've answered correctly.
Yeah, hello. Yes, ma'am. I asked that question.
So have I answered, or is there anything else that you would like to ask? I don't know if I've answered what you wanted to know.
I was thinking from the point of view, if you are generating random numbers, if it is dependent on some condition, because any algorithm again would be based on some condition, then how can it be truly random? Because if I can replicate those conditions again, then the randomness goes away, right?
Absolutely. So if there's a preset way of generating, then yes.
Okay. Okay.
Are there any further questions? Yes, it will be released on YouTube. I can share the link, the YouTube link. Okay, if there are no further questions, I would like to thank Haneet for such a very interesting topic, which left us with a lot of questions and things to think about. Lastly, I would like everyone to make sure that they have filled the form, the feedback form. I'm sharing the link again. So please fill up the form before leaving the session. It will help us improve this school synergy workshop.
Thank you, everyone. And my motto was only to initiate a dialogue. I'm sure most of the things would have not been cleared in the first go. Please take a look at the YouTube session, the video, and if you have anything to comment or share with me, please do write to me. Thank you, the organizers, for giving me this chance to share my work with a larger audience in India.
Thanks, Anish. Thank you so much that in spite of issues at home and other things, you still managed to do the session for us. And I think it was a very interesting session, and many people joined. More than 100 people had joined for this session. So really, we all enjoyed it very much. Thanks a lot, Anish.
Thank you. Thanks, Ruchi. Thank you, Zina.
Yeah. Okay. Bye for now then.